Hello, and a warm welcome to our time of worship together on Sunday the 6th of December, the second Sunday of Advent. As part of our service today, we'll be thinking about a character called Zechariah. He was John the Baptist's dad, and we're going to be looking at how he can help us to understand more about Advent, more about Christmas, and more about Jesus. And there's going to be some fantastic artwork and some questions for you to think about at home as well as we do that. But first of all, we're going to light our second Advent candle, and then we're going to sing a worship song together. So we're going to light our first two Advent candles. Are you ready, Jacob? Okay, here we go. This one first. Oh, well done. Don't blow it out, not yet. And then this one, blow it out in a minute. Big blow. Well, well done. Okay, the first two candles are lit. Shall we pray?
Yes.
Okay. Lord Jesus, thank you that you are the light of the world. Amen. As you can see, we're starting to get ready for Christmas here. And one of the things I'll be doing in the next week or so is buying the Christmas edition of the Radio Times, the only time of the year I ever buy it. But I love a bit of Christmas TV. And one of the great things about this time of year is there are so many films and hopefully good TV programmes on. Is there a film that you're really looking forward to watching over Christmas? Have you got a favourite Christmas film? Well, we're going to find out from some people now about what their favourite Christmas films are. And then we're going to hear from Susie.
My favourite film is Jumanji.
My favourite film is Christmas Chronicles.
My favourite Christmas film is Home Alone 2.
My favourite film is The Christmas Chronicles.
My favourite film is A Christmas Carol.
My favourite film is Christmas Chronicles 2.
My favourite film is Jurassic World.
My favourite Christmas film is Nativity.
My favourite film is Incredibles 2, Superheroes.
My favourite film is Aladdin.
My favourite film is Mary Poppins.
My favourite Christmas film is The Snowman.
My favourite film is The Nativity.
My favourite Christmas film is The Grinch.
My favourite Christmas film is Get Santa.
My favourite film is Spider-Man Far From Home.
My favourite Christmas film is The Star.
Our favourite Christmas film is Elf.
Well, thank you for sharing all your favourite films with us. Do you know, we love films in our house, and every Friday night we have our family film night, and we've just started on the Christmas films, which is really exciting. So I just wonder, why do you think films are so popular? Why do we have favourite films? I think it's because each film tells a really good story, and we love a good story, don't we? And Christmas is all based around a story. An exciting story that involves animals and angels and a girl who's not even married and she's going to have a baby. And there's a baddie who wants to kill the baby and some wise men who ride on a camel and some shepherds out on a hill. There's this amazing story of Christmas, but you know, the best thing of all is actually this story is true. So this story wasn't written by Disney or by DreamWorks. This story was written by God himself. God wrote this story, a true story that really happened, it really came alive. A baby actually was born onto this earth, into a stable or a place where there were animals. And he came so that he could bring love and joy and hope and light to all of us. So this year, while you're watching your favourite Christmas films, and I hope you do that lots, we certainly will be in our house, just remember that Christmas is based on a true story, a real story of hope, of God coming to earth to be with us. Now I'm going to hand over to John, who's going to tell us a reading from the Bible, but this reading has a real difference, so watch on because it's going to be really interesting.
Well, the reading is Luke 1, verses 57 to 80, the birth of John the Baptist. And in this reading, you will hear that John's mother is called Elizabeth, that his father is called Zechariah, and who couldn't speak for quite some time, but later prophesied about the coming of Jesus, and also prophesied about the role of his own son in preparing the way for the coming of Jesus. Well, as you can see, I'm painting angels at the moment, and in particular, the angel Gabriel, who appeared to Zechariah whilst Zechariah was doing his priestly duties in the inner temple. It's a busy time for Gabriel. Later on, he has to appear to Mary with some very important news. What do angels look like, though? We all have different opinions on what an angel looks like. Angel Gabriel, in my picture, doesn't have wings. But lots of angels' pictures do. St. John's is full of angels. I don't know whether you realise. Most of them have angel wings, but they're very interesting. Take a look. Thank you. Google angel images to see what different artists have come up with, you'll be surprised at all the different interpretations you can see. Why not make your own image of an angel this Christmas time, and you could display it in your window. You can see Gabriel, Zechariah in my picture is an old man, that's using the words he uses, and his wife Elizabeth is well on in years, so Zechariah says. They desperately wanted a child and prayed to God for one, but now they feel they are too old. He's looking scared because Gabriel has surprised him. But it's good news. God will answer their prayers, and Elizabeth will give birth to a son, and Zechariah is to call him John. Now Zechariah does something silly. He challenges the angel by saying that he thinks they're too old to have a child. Mistake. Would you challenge an angel sent by God? No. Anyway, God takes his voice away to teach him a lesson. Can you imagine the scene when Zechariah gets home and tries to communicate to Elizabeth what has happened to him today and what is going to happen to them in the future? The Bible is silent on that, but it's an interesting thing to think about, isn't it? Anyway, it turns right in the end. Listen to this. When it was time for Elizabeth to have her baby, she gave birth to a son. Her neighbours and relatives heard that the Lord had shown her great mercy, and they shared her joy. On the eighth day, they came to circumcise the child, and they were going to name him after his father, Zechariah. But his mother spoke up and said, "No, he is to be called John." They said to her, "There is no one among your relatives who has that name." Then they made signs to his father to find out what he would like to name the child. He asked for a writing tablet, and to everyone's astonishment, he wrote, "His name is John." Immediately, his mouth was opened and his tongue was loosed, and he began to speak, praising God. The neighbours were all filled with awe, and throughout the hill country of Judea, people were talking about all these things. Everyone who heard this wondered about it, asking, "What then is this child going to be?" For the Lord's hand was with him. His father Zechariah was filled with the Holy Spirit and prophesied, "Praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, because he has come to his people and redeemed them. He has raised up a horn," that's a king, "of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he said through his holy prophets of long ago, salvation from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to show mercy to our ancestors and to remember his holy covenant, the oath he swore to our father Abraham, to rescue us from the hand of the enemies and to enable us to serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all our days." Then he looks at the baby. "You, my child, will be called a prophet of the Most High, for you will go on before the Lord to prepare the way for him, to give his people the knowledge of salvation through the forgiveness of their sins, because of the tender mercy of our God, by which the rising sun will come to us from heaven, to shine on those living in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the path of peace." And the child grew and became strong in spirit, and he lived in the wilderness until he appeared publicly to Israel. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you so much, John. What an incredible piece of artwork. And I'm actually now in church surrounded by some of the angels that you've just seen on the screen. They are everywhere in St. John's. And I hope that you maybe want to take up that challenge to be creative during Advent, and you might want to draw or create an angel. If you do, why don't you send us a photo of it and we can show some of those photos in future services. You've also had a chance to think about your favourite Christmas film, and thanks to all the children who told us about theirs. One of mine is the classic Christmas Carol. And when I say classic, I mean, of course, The Muppets Christmas Carol. It's bound to be on over Christmas. I'm sure we'll sit down as a family and watch it. If you've not seen it before, you'll get a chance, I'm sure, this year. They tell the story really well, actually. It's good fun, but it's fairly faithful, I think, to the original story too. Just think about Scrooge for a minute in the story of the Christmas Carol. His life is on a trajectory which is not a good one. His future seems doomed. And then there's this incredible intervention which changes everything. And it's to do with the past, the present, and the future. And when Scrooge is given a glimpse of those three things, the past, the present, and the future, it's enough to bring about a real change in his life. Great story. And of course, the Christmas story is all about the fact that God has intervened to change the trajectory, the direction of our lives. And Zechariah understands that this is what is happening. He gets it. And he has that period of silence, which John's referred to. And sometimes the most fitting response to the awesomeness of God is silence. And then when we get to the section that you just heard John read, we see Zechariah burst forth into praise. When John, his son, is born, he's able, like a champagne bottle being uncorked, the praise just flows out from him. And actually the silence, and there is singing. And this Christmas, I hope that we'll find time for both. Because we can't sing in church this Christmas, because services are going to be different, I hope that when the church is open, that's going to be a time to come and be still and to reflect and to, just like Mary did, to ponder and to treasure the truth of the Christmas story. But then when we have our services online, from the comfort of your own home, you'll be able to sing and raise your voice. And that's going to be a great way to worship as well. Silence and singing. It's all there in the Christmas story. It's there in the story of Zechariah. But in Zechariah's song of praise, which again, if you want to read it some other time or as a devotion this week, it's Luke chapter 1, verse 67 to 80. He understands there's something about the past, the present, and the future in what God is doing. It helps him to understand what God is doing. Just like Scrooge and the spirits of the past, present, and the future, so too in these verses we see Zechariah referencing all three. And here's just a few examples of it. First of all, he says, "Praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, because he has come and redeemed his people. He has raised up salvation for us." Zechariah is speaking in the present tense. God has come. He's here now. He recognizes that the promise that he's been waiting for is now beginning to be fulfilled. God is at work in the present. This isn't now just a hope for the future, nor just a hope born in the past. But right now, God is at work. This is what he's doing. Zechariah perceives it. He understands it. It's like the hinge on a door is beginning to open. And it's actually the hinge of history, from the Old Testament to the New, from the Old Covenant to the New, to life without Jesus, to life with Jesus. An incredible moment in history. Zechariah gets it. God is at work now. Praise God for that. He's at work in my life. He's at work in your life. He's at work in the life of our church. He's at work in the world. We need to watch and perceive and pray about what God is doing at the moment. But he does then reach into the past in his song of worship as well. And he says that what God is doing is what he said he would do long ago through the prophets, and what he swore to our father Abraham that he would do. To understand what God's doing now, Zechariah has to reach into the past, remind himself of the promises of God. That understanding of our heritage is so, so important. We need to understand the Old Testament. We need to understand the way in which it points to Jesus. And in our own lives, we need to reach back and be reminded of the things he's done in our lives, the ways in which he has helped us and blessed us and saved us and set our feet upon a rock, as the psalmist says. But this is a worship song that also has an eye on the future. And there's the immediate future in the context of what Zechariah is going through, which is that his son John will prepare the way for the Messiah, for Jesus. And he says this is what the Messiah will do. He will shine on those living in darkness and guide our feet into the way of peace. Zechariah understands that this is what Jesus will do. In fact, he says the dawn from on high is breaking upon us. If ever you've seen the sunrise, you can't help but be captivated by the awesomeness and the beauty of it. Just as the sun each day illuminates the earth, Zechariah knows that when Jesus comes, he will illuminate the world. He will illuminate the lives of the people who he comes to bless. And if you don't know Jesus, I promise you that's what he does, even now, through his Holy Spirit. He illuminates our lives. He said he was the light of the world, and he brings light and life to us. Get in touch if you don't know Jesus. We can talk about it. We can tell you more about what an incredible thing it is to know the light that he brings. And Zechariah was absolutely right. This is what Jesus would do. He did it for the people that he met. He did it for Peter and James and John and the disciples. He did it for Bartimaeus and Zacchaeus and Mary and Martha and Lazarus and Nicodemus, people on the edges of society who were struggling. He spoke to the rich and the powerful as well. He brought light, illumination to the world. And it's what he still does today. And as Zechariah says, he guides our feet into the way of peace. It doesn't mean peace and quiet, although that's great and nice, and I hope we get a bit of it this Christmas. But actually, the deep peace of God, the peace of being reconciled with God, being able to be close to him again. That's what he leads us into. And so Zechariah understood what was going on. He was able to perceive it, and he was able to worship. Well, as we think about the past, what God is doing now, and also the future, as we think about the incredible gift of Jesus to the world, the illumination that he brings to our lives, we're now going to worship God together with a song which is all about God's faithfulness. Let's worship.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. I'm not afraid. the goodness of God.
Many people still live their lives with a sense of darkness and a lack of peace. And so we're now going to spend some time praying for our community and praying for our world.
Let us pray. And let's start with the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Amen. Let's just take a moment to just stay in his presence, and we say, come Holy Spirit, minister to us today, minister to our hearts. For those who need healing, bring healing to body, mind and spirit. Come Lord. And Father God, we just come before you this morning with the needs of our nation. Lord, we are 3-4 weeks away from Brexit, with all that that brings, with trading agreements and negotiations with governments. And Father, so we lift particularly Boris Johnson and our government to you, the Queen and the royal family, that you would give them health and strength and wisdom, and most of all that good decisions would be made, that parties would respect each other and they would deal with each other with honour and integrity, that they would treat each other with honesty and kindness. For the decisions with the EU and for Northern Ireland in particular, and for our farming community, as they will lose their European grants. Lord, we acknowledge you as Jehovah Jireh, our provider, and we look to you for your provision. Lord, at this unusual time of Advent, when we wonder at your coming, we say, come Emmanuel to our local town, Weymouth, Portland. We say, come Lord Jesus. We watch our town centre now struggling with many shops closing, causing uncertainty and job losses, deprivation, poverty and mental health issues. Lord, we lift up the work of our local churches for refresh, for family matters, for safe sleep, for the lantern, CAP, the street pastors, potluck team, food bank, and for the new shop, The Nest, the community shop that's opening soon in Abbotsbury Road. Lord, these organisations are hearing your word and hearing your call for us to feed the hungry and help the needy. So bless those who are involved, Lord. Protect them in whatever way they serve you in this area. Lord Zechariah realised as he held his son that he was making a way for Jesus, who would be the guiding light to bring peace. So, Lord, we ask for peace in this nation and peace at this time, that you would pour out your spirit. And, Lord, my prayer to end for today is from a fairly old worship song. But we say, Lord, we long for you to move in power. There's a hunger deep within our hearts to see healing in our nation. Send your spirit to revive us. Heal our nation. Heal our nation. Pour out your spirit on this land. And that's our prayer today. Pour out your spirit, Lord. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
And so we've thought about that incredible story, and we're going to end by singing a commitment to sharing it with others. So let's sing again.
I will sing the wondrous story of the Christ who died for me.
Let's pray as we close. Lord God, we thank you so much for the opportunity to worship you this morning, to reflect on the Christmas story, to think about Advent, to think about the past, the present and the future, to know that you are faithful and you are with us. And as we go into the rest of this week, this Advent season, may we know the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son and the Holy Spirit, with us today and with us forever. Amen.